Imagine having to store 50 billion pictures and videos on your measly little computer. That's close to 95 million videos per day. For regular users like us, there is no possible way we could even store a fraction of this on a single hard drive. For weird people, well, I don't want to bother talking about what those images are on your computer. For Instagram, this is a reality for all of its users uploading pictures and videos to its servers every single second of the day. Now, you're probably thinking, Instagram has this all under control though, right? Well, Instagram looked at their metrics and saw that in 12 months, their servers will crash if they didn't find a better way to store their videos. In this video, we're gonna find out how Instagram made a 94% improvement to the process of storing and processing videos that saved its servers from crashing 12 months down the line. If you want more stories like this, check out my newsletter, The Better Dev. We release a 2x a week newsletter showing you things like this, open source software, and more. All right, let's get started. When you have 2 billion monthly active users, by the way, that's like literally a quarter of the earth using Instagram, you have to find the best way to make sure your servers are keeping up with the constant traffic. With this many users, 10 minutes of downtime is considered a disaster. After doing some projections within 12 months, they realized something scary. They wouldn't be able to have enough computing capacity to provide video uploads for everyone. Now, do I have to explain why this is bad? No video equals no fun equals no Instagram. The way they have their servers set up is extremely complex. Meta, I'm still having a hard time not calling them Facebook, by the way, has 14 data centers across the entire world that helps load balance all traffic towards their applications. It's very complicated, but there's a great article below showing a high level of how they actually load balance all this traffic. It's in the description. Anyway, back to the storage issue. Instagram wanted to instead optimize their server they were running rather than getting new ones. Imagine opening up another data center. One second, let me look this up. Okay, yeah, let's maybe save some cash here. So they scouted around their servers to see how they can save computing power when a user uploaded a video. They found a potential way to shave some optimizations. This is very common amongst a lot of video applications for accessibility purposes. When you upload a video, that video service will compress the files into multiple different videos. They do this because sometimes you're watching from a bad internet connection or you're looking at it through a thumbnail. You wouldn't want to load a 12K video in the thumbnail. That's how your data bill goes through the roof. So they run this function to create videos depending on what view you're looking at. Okay, let's look at this function more in depth. Whenever someone uploads a video on Instagram, the server will generate many videos in these two types. One was the H.264 codec, and the other was AV1 codec. So because developers are weird like that, they went into the function and did some tests. They found that the function took 86.17 seconds to run. So with roughly 4 million videos per hour, you can see how their computing is getting extremely backed up. Yikes. Let's look at these two video types. As mentioned before, we're dealing with two video codecs. One is H.264 and the other is AV1. Okay, please, please, please stay. I know talking about video compression is kind of boring, but I promise you I'll make it fun. Let's look at our boy H.264. We love H.264. Almost all videos you see online for the most part are encoded with H.264. It's been around forever, and the first release being all the way back in 2003. If you really want to nerd out and tell all the people at the party how video compression works, then I won't explain in detail how it works here. There's lots of great videos on that, by the way. However, the SparkNotes version is that it works by analyzing the differences between the next frame and the last frame, and removes things that are the same to save memory. It also removes any information that is unnecessary in a frame and stores it more efficiently. For a detailed look, go to Leo's channel and check out this video. It's seriously incredible. Links in the description. But 20 years of development comes with a massive amount of baggage. So some of the biggest tech companies put research into making a new video compression system that can outperform H.264. The Alliance for Open Media, which was founded founded in 2015 by Amazon, Facebook, Google, Microsoft, and Netflix, released AO Media Video 1, also known as AV1. This technology is incredible as you can get 30% smaller video size and better quality. Huh? But the best part of it all is that it's open source and royalty free. So it's a win-win, essentially. However, with the way technology is, it's really new. So it takes a while for people to adopt. My grandma is still asking me how to turn on her webcam, okay? So long story short, they have two types of encodings that they are generating. One is H.264, which is used in every single device, but lower quality. This was spending 80% of the resources available. And two, AV1, which is new and better, but not used on all devices. They wanted to start generating this more since it's much, much better. Okay, you didn't fall asleep, did you? Okay, 80% of the resources? That's a lot of resources. Let's investigate. Let's look at the minimum functionality encodings, AKA the H.264, which we love, by the way. I'm not a hater. Instagram creates two classes of minimum functionality encodings. One is basic adaptive bitrate encodings, and two is progressive encodings. The basic adaptive bitrate encoding is Instagram's most popular encoding for its users. You know when you're watching a video and your internet gets wonky, so you get a blurry version of it temporarily? That technique of streaming is called adaptive bitrate streaming. These people are smart, you know. The other one isn't used nearly as often, but is needed to support very old versions of the app. What did I tell you? It's always the old tech that's ruining it for everyone. When we test uploading a 23-second 720p video to the servers, they found that it took 86 seconds. Yikes. However, an oversight was discovered. The programmers noticed that the settings of the two encoders were very, very similar. So a light bulb went off. What if they could replace the adaptive bitrate encodings with the progressive encodings video frames by repackaging them into an advanced bitrate capable file structure? Okay. That sounds really complicated. Basically, if all the settings are on the same crappy progressive encodings, why not just repackage it so the other encoding can get a head start instead of creating it all from scratch? That way, they both don't have to chug along at the exact same time. Almost like instead of having them race against each other, you make them pass the baton. I think that analogy was clever. It was at least worth a try. So they got ahead and tested it. Once they ran their initial tests, 0.36 seconds. Wait, they must have done that wrong. Nope, 0.36 seconds. Okay, let's review what they did here. Before, they would upload a file and at the same time, transcode two different video files. If you've ever rendered a video or made a 3D render on your computer before, you know that this is a very hefty process. So this poor server was chugging this along for so long. Instead, they switched it so that it would render out the old version and then repackage most of the settings and frames from the previous encodings so it didn't have to render all the way. This would free up computer for the advanced coding I mentioned at the beginning of this video. Remember AV1? Please, please, please don't make me talk about video encoding again. Now, I want to say that this seems simple, but when everything you work on is supposed to scale to billions of users, it's a common oversight. Oh, speaking of scaling to billions, let's test if billions can handle this. Now, a lot of people want to talk crap about programmers who work at big tech companies for not fixing a minor bug fast. But the issue is the amount of hurdles you have to jump over to get your code in a production environment is a lot. And here is no exception. They needed to test if this optimization that would allow for generating more advanced encodings be a net positive for users. This can't be complicated, right? Did you not listen to what I just said two sentences ago? To test to see if this would work, they created two pools of regular simulated traffic. Both were routed to a test pool or a control pool. For when the video was delivered, it would identify if the encodings from the new system was implemented. Do you now believe me that nothing is easy when you're scaling this thing up to billions of people? From this test, they proved that they were degrading the compression efficiency of the original AVR encodings, but the extreme higher wash time from the advanced AV1 encodings more than made up for it. Over 94% of computing power was saved with this small optimization. But what can we take away from it? Well, to me, a couple things really stand out from this. One is how we really need to consistently invest in innovating things that we think are good enough. Good enough, of course. My last 4K video that was 12 minutes long was 30 gigabytes in QuickTime format. But in H.264, it was around 800 megabytes. To the common eye, that doesn't even seem like it needs optimization. That's like a 97% compression rate. However, understanding that things can get better will help us innovate for many different things that we can use in the future. Two is the fact that they were able to reduce that much computing power with one simple trick is not a sign of bad engineering. There's lots of reasons why oversights like this can happen in software engineering. The classic, if it ain't broke, don't fix it, is a common term used in environments like this to insinuate that there are more important priorities elsewhere, like creating an exciting new feature over creating an optimization that not many people will realize or care about. Of course, this term is affiliated with technical debt, which is a term used to describe doing the easy solution first that you eventually will have to fix at a later point. Number three is creating a transparent approach to fixing this issue that a lot of us don't understand. Software engineers are always giving back to the community, whether that's white papers, talks, or literal source code that are the backbones of giant tech companies. The transparency and vulnerability it takes to make an article like this are great traits for any types of engineers. I hope you enjoyed this video. Let me know what company I should do next in the comments below. If you haven't seen it already, I made a video on how Discord stores billions of messages per month. Go check it out. Make sure you like, comment, and subscribe for more dev and tech content. Peace out, coders.